I think one of the first questions we're going to be asking is, whether threat intelligence is actually necessary or attribution is necessary. Does it make any difference if we know who's attacking us?
$10 billion, by far the biggest cyber attack in history.
Within 15 minutes, their entire environment was taken down.
The thing that really amazed me were how many corollaries were being drawn from the military.
I've worked very, very closely with CISOs over the last 2-3 years, and the challenges they face are amazing.
We kind of just touched the surface. There is so much more to this conversation.
If we start by looking at the threats that an organization can face, generally you can face commodity threats. It's the type of malware, cybercrime that we hear about a lot. And then you can also have some more bespoke threats that are targeting a specific sector or a specific company. Now, obviously, the way you will handle those is very different. And threat intelligence feeds and support can actually help you to be effective in defending against both type of threats. But obviously, what we traditionally call cyber hygiene and a cybersecurity program around controls and implementation actually is probably one of the most effective things any organization can do.
So I think traditionally intelligence has been a little bit more passive in terms of receiving information, acting on information, and then contributing back into the environment in order to secure better the controls, change the controls. Threat hunting, to me has been a fascinating sort of more proactive, right? It's almost as though we finally get to go on the offensive side. And so I've been absolutely fascinated, again, where you see the companies that have the ability to do that, or again, can reach out and take advantage of service providers that can enable and help them to do that. But yeah, to actually take advantage of understanding what do we see in the environment, so the data, the logs, the activity that's happening in our environment, and then how can we threat hunt against what we know is out there, against whether it's different feeds that we get, whether it's those indicators of compromise, and then pull out and pursue those things within the organization. So yeah, really fascinating. The other thing I think is interesting is to look at it in the general terms of the threat landscape. So different companies operating in different spaces have a completely different threat landscape that they're up against, So for example, there might be an organization that's of nation state interest, therefore draws in nation state attackers. So you're looking at things like regulated entities, obviously looking at oil and gas, anything that's critical national infrastructure, all the way down to potentially mom and pop shops, that have a presence online, even maybe grocery stores, retail chains, things like that have an online presence. Their ability to leverage and look at their maturity of their security controls against the threat landscape, the spend that they're going to put against that will potentially be less than what, say, a nation state attacker would require. And so it's being able to understand what business am I in, what does the industry dictate in terms of the type of attacker that I'm up against, and that threat landscape, I think, that needs to be taken into consideration.
And as you say, it's mass campaigns around the world. And if they find a hit, then they'll push it onto another department. That other department will then go in further into your organization. It's stopping that. It's finding what else they're doing. That's where the threat hunting comes really valuable, looking at what they're doing, looking at their techniques and seeing, right, has that applied anywhere else in the organization? And can we stop it before it gets any further?
We can see in threat intelligence and then leading to attribution, you have the commodity feeds, as I said earlier. So it's things that your system can protect you against, and it's the indicators of compromise, and you're checking for those. What is very useful is to track your adversaries. So that's more than just the traditional threat intelligence. It's when you're in-house starting to do your own analysis. So you're looking at particular adversary types or adversary groups, and then linking that back to the tools, techniques, processes they use. Because it's actually one of the few ways that you can validate your own security controls. And we would expect our red team to mimic particular threat actor types. So then when you have the detection rules in the security operation centers, you want to know that they're effective. So I think that's fairly normal for a mature security practice. And that's quite useful and valuable if you have the resource and the availability to be able to start tracking certainly attacker types, attacker groups, what's going on. But for me, that's short of attribution. And I think that's where sometimes we get confused as an industry, because once some people say, well, that's attribution because it was actor X or Y or Z. And it's not. It's just keeping an eye on the type of adversaries, the type of tool, the type of things. And that I would certainly encourage people to be doing as part of a threat intelligence program. And I, for the attribution question itself, I think I agree with Becky, to be honest. I think for a commercial organization, it's, unless you're prosecuting, it's a crime. The benefits of actually forensically and analyzing and then linking back, attribution is only possible with a prosecution element, and actually, quite frankly, working with government agencies who work in that space, because they will, and you need other sources of evidence. You're never going to have that as a commercial organization in itself. Where I think as an industry we could really benefit from is helping then the internal teams to be much more efficient in how they do that bespoke analysis, provide context around that threat intelligence, and really how it's integrated through APIs or software into a wider cybersecurity risk management or asset management or vulnerability management dashboard. Only by having all of those things fully integrated can you truly be effective. So I don't think it's anything specific for threat intelligence. I think it's a much broader answer about how we best utilize cybersecurity data across the business, would be what I would find really beneficial.